and 44-year radio counselor, Roy Masters.
The problem with religion is that it's taught. You cannot learn it, and it will work for you. It is literally impossible. I'm going to emphasize it, if you don't mind, and sort of awaken you from the stupor you might be in because of it. At the very beginning of the Bible, it says, "Of all the trees you may freely eat, by the knowledge of good and the knowledge of evil." Isn't that clear? You cannot learn it. That doesn't mean to say it doesn't have the language of it and the history of it and the instruction of it. Isn't any use. I'm not saying that. There's a roadmap has a value. You read. Turn right, turn left. Go to New York, turn north. On highway, whatever it is. You read. You follow the instructions. If you read the instructions for your exercise machine, and you don't use the exercise machine, but you just read the instructions, how would you develop muscles? There is the knowledge of anything is extremely tantalizing because it promises power over people. Knowledge is power, they would say. I would agree. You think I don't have knowledge? I put my mind to anything, I could learn it, but I wouldn't learn it like you would learn it. I'd learn it more slowly than you would learn it. I want to understand it. See, the truth of the matter is that everything in the universe, all the knowledge in the universe, not that you're ever going to discover all of that, each one of us is appointed to know just as much to bring about God's plan on earth as it is in heaven. You got your plan, you got your unfolding, I've got mine, I got my, all our jobs. I can't do your job, you can't do my job. Not all, everybody can be leaders. I mean, political leaders, religious leaders, or whatever leaders there is. Somebody has to have, you know, has to have a head of an organization. Otherwise, you won't have any shoes. Everybody can do everything, anything they want, and you won't get any product. The organizer. It's called government. Household. But we all have purpose. And the trouble is you're having difficulty finding yours. Is that right? So I used to ask my mother, what can I do? What's my purpose? She'd go play with your big toe. Don't ask me. That was the way of saying, what do you expect me to tell you what to do? You got to go find it for yourself. I asked my father, what about God? He said, I don't know much about it. You're going to have to go find it for yourself. That was pretty freeing. And I did. And just because no one told me, and when they did, it didn't mean anything anyway. It was who that said it. It's not the thing that said, it's who that says it. If somebody, an actor on the stage, says something that Jesus said, it wouldn't have the same thing as him saying it, or Bob Hope, for that matter. He can make you laugh. I could make you laugh with the same line. So it's a who, isn't it? It's a where a person's coming from. So then you got words. The good book says, faith cometh by the word, but the word by hearing. I wonder if you understand the brilliance of that. Do you know how many people in the world really understand what I just said? The scripture, the preacher will quote it, of making books, there is no end, much with learning is a weariness. It got all kind. They can quote anything. Thy will be done. Forgive us as we forgive our trespasses. They just make noises. They act out what they think it is, and it isn't. We're talking about most people who are dead. They're dead, but they won't not lie down. In time, they will. And I'm hoping that you will grasp in a fraction of a second. It may happen any minute. I'm not asking you to grasp it because it's not something I could hypnotize you to do. You will now grasp the significance of creation and you will be saved. See, it's not something you can inculcate into a person's mind or program. It's almost like it's in God's time. There's a moment of awakening. It could be this minute. It could be when you're driving your car or having a shower. It could be 20 years from now and all of a sudden things that I've said come to mind. And bingo, something happens. And you're completely detached. And all of a sudden, your worries and cares disappear. The burden comes off your shoulders. And you're free. The truth having made you free. It was germinating in you somewhere. And even Jesus said something similar. He said, I must go away. You cannot understand me now. I will send the Holy Spirit and he will bear witness to the things I say. You'll understand it. You couldn't always be the teacher. You got to go away and then send something that gives us the aha experience. Now, the aha experience is life. Now I understand what my mother said. No, usually it's not your mother. And it should be your father, but it isn't him either. You know what I mean? But whatever, whenever, now I understand what Roy Master says. In that moment, you're free from that particular thing. But it begins from the very root cause. You cannot have that sequence. You can't have one. You can't have 2 + 1 makes 3 unless you got 1 + 1. And you can't have 1 unless you know there's 1. And how about the one who made the universe, bearing witness to himself in all the creation, all the 1s and 2s and 3s, all the logarithms of creation. See? That's all it is. Bunch of numbers, science. Of course, there's more to it than that, but it's a progression universe made up of very few principles. Maybe only 1 becoming 2 becoming 4 becoming 6 becoming God knows 8, 12, 24, 48, exponentially. But it's all the same things. We're beginning to understand that everything is made. It's like having a house of bricks and eating jelly and peanut butter sandwiches, all bricks. Except strangely, these numbers arrange themselves in circles and cycles and orbits that produce different chemistries, like elements and compounds, endless, so that it looks different. And then living things. How are we going to understand this mystery? Can a tree understand a tree? Can't. You can understand yourself, but you can barely understand yourself because you won't. Is that good? He's got a shoe, so he doesn't have to hear me. I have to tell you a little story. I had a fellow by the name of Frank. I can't remember his last name. And I took him out of welfare because he was an intelligent fellow. Welfare gave him a car and gave him an apartment. He didn't have to work. He sort of played around with the welfare system in England. So I gave him a job organizing foundation over there. He eventually cheated me, and that was the end of it. He took advantage of the opportunity I gave him, and there is no more. He's an opportunist. That's where he was, and that's where he went back to. But he would say to me, he would listen to all my lectures over Radio Caroline. That's a boat in the middle of the English Channel, which sort of like a pirate radio. Didn't obey the laws of any country. Eventually, the Dutch Navy dismantled it. But I was on there for years. I had a big following in England, and knew exactly what to say. He would lecture in my stead. He'd learned everything word by word, just like a person. He's intelligent. He could learn everything. He'd learned it, and people would believe him. But they would believe him more than me, because he wasn't so threatening. See, intellectually, when you speak things, and you learn from the Bible, and you become an authority, and here you know all the answers, you know the whole Bible from end to end, you got a clerical collar, you believe that person's word as if it was gospel, and it isn't. More believable than me. Isn't the preacher on your pulpit more believable to those people than I am? You can't get them in here. They're caught up in the spoken word. And he used to say to me, getting back to the story, he used to make for himself, since he was pretty lazy, spaghetti and meatballs. And he used to call it spaghetti bolognese. That was his... It was horrible. I had some. I guess it had to be horrible because it had to distract him. It can't taste that good, but it could taste that bad. And it works either way. Pleasure or pain can distract you. So he said, while I'm listening to you, I'd eat my spaghetti bolognese. And that way I didn't have to understand anything. Now I can see my wife when I'm talking to her. And so she's moving something around. I said, what'd you do that for? Oh, I wanted to put the milk in the refrigerator. I said, I'm talking to you about something. She's thinking about putting milk in the refrigerator. See? And she's listening to me, but she has to be preoccupied with something so that she doesn't actually hear what I'm saying. Because that is a process that when you talk to people, their mind distracts them. And I'm doing my best to try to caution you about the intellectual process in which you are caught. Because that's what's wrong with all of us. All of us. No exceptions. Me, even including me to some degree. I'm not completely free yet. I'm freer than you are. It's a process. Couldn't talk the way I talk if I wasn't. I have that clarity. I don't have to study what I'm going to say. I just get here and talk. Sometimes it's good and sometimes it isn't. I don't always know which is, you decide. But you are caught up in that intellectual process. And you've trained your brain to distract you so that you don't have to face anything. You don't like to see what's wrong with yourself. Yes, you could see what's wrong with others. Double standard. You know right from wrong. You know right from wrong when you see it. You know injustice when you see it. But then you judge it and you're focused on their problem and not yours, and even have memories of it. You know, you have an accounting of these things. You've got a whole, you know, accounting book in your head. And your own wrongs go unnoticed and they grow. Because anytime you are distracted from your own problem and you go about righting your own wrongs by comparing you someone else more wrong than yourself, it's a denial, we call it. And every denial is a sin. So there's two parts to sin. The wrong itself, but the worst part is the excuse. The worst part is the mechanism by which you don't face yourself. And I've mentioned a couple just now. It could be music, it could be focusing on women's breasts and private parts and all kinds of things that you know that arouse emotions. What do you think if you turn the TV channels? What do you see? Cheesecake, they call it. All you see is that's morning, noon and night, and silly people dumping around and waving their torsos and little fannies in your face, thousands and millions of fannies, all day long, with silly moves, silly gestures and motions designed to stimulate and to excite. Some ladies with Elvis Presley go crazy with excitement. And you also may go crazy with excitement. If you just go to a concert, just watch. I haven't been to a concert. A long, long time ago, I went to, a promoter, sociopath tried to involve me with a movie. He used me to get funds for this movie, knowing that I wanted to make a movie. He took me to a very expensive place in London. And he gave me the box in the front seat. And all these girls were dancing and throwing themselves up in the air in certain gyrations. Unmentionable. You know. And the music was so loud. And I just sat there and I could hear the noise around me. It was just noise. And he asked me how I liked it. I said I didn't. But I saw everybody else applauding, standing up. Wonderful. Because why? Because all of this was designed to take them away a couple of hours from the misery of their existence. And how grateful they are for that relief. It's almost like salvation. When somebody loves you and sort of swoons you off your feet, when somebody makes you angry and you get puffed up, distracted, judgmental, when you go to church and you feel lifted by the trappings, you're distracted. And while you're distracted, there's the moanings of the preacher and the various ceremonies and the lighting of candles and the various things they do for a couple hours. And you're caught up in the solemnity of it. And the whole of the church and everything in it seems to be for you. The little child says, look at me, daddy. That you do, look. But you don't encourage it, you look. But they want that attention because they want to be the center of the universe. The girls that wave their little torsos around and make millions of dollars, they do it very well. They love being the center of the universe. They turn on millions of people away from themselves. It's the whole idea. The better you do it, the funnier you are, the more lurid you are, the more perverse you are, the more exciting personality you are, the more you animate people because they're dead, you excite them, you stimulate them, you press all their buttons. The more you can do that, the more you are valued. Someone dies for their country, he just dies for his country. But that Michael Jackson and Elvis Presley is halfway innocent, you know. It was the people that killed him. He didn't know how to deal with the power. That's why he had died from an overdose of drugs. He couldn't stand the pain of worship, but he couldn't stop being the puppet. Couldn't stop it. He needed it, and it killed him. The very thing he needs killed you. And as a matter of fact, your own lovers will kill you. You will be drawn to the very thing that's killing you. the cigarettes, the drugs, your wife, your husband, the wrong ones. You elect the wrong ones because they promise what they cannot deliver. They will not deliver. They promise falsely. They excite, they stimulate, they lie. Or you even love liars because lie has more power. You can invent a whole poetry of lies. You can get a Nobel Prize for that, being a poet laureate. You're a drunken bum on cocaine and alcohol, but you're very good with playing with words. And if you read those words, they don't say anything. They just paint pictures in your imagination, which you can convert into theater. Right or wrong. Every now and then, you have something that's worthwhile reading, literature. But, you know, modern day, forget it. Rudyard Kipling's If is like the Lord's Prayer. If you keep your head while others are losing yours, and so on and so forth, I don't remember the whole thing. It was just beautiful. See, I don't have the memory for it, but I have the appreciation of it every time I read it. Because if I have memory for it, I think I know it. But if I just read it, there's something there I never saw before. If you read the Bible without memorizing it, as if you knew it, and that's the end of it. But if you read it with an understanding, it opens up. The, like, veil falls from your eyes. So if you just read the Bible and just look for the nugget, look, just scan it. But your preacher says, study. And the study is the bad part. Learn. Learning is the bad part. And as I said a few moments ago, that there's not a thing in this universe that if it was appointed to you to understand, you could grasp it. In a manner of speaking, every one of us knows everything in the universe, except it's not accessible to us, only what we need to know, and that's good enough. You're not God, so you don't need to know everything in the universe. But you will know it because it's born into you to know it if you will give up the power that comes from knowledge over people. See how I said that? The respect and the riches and the honor that showered on you if you're smart. And if you're very inferior, if you've been made to feel inferior, you can compensate for knowledge quite innocently. When I say there are some people who love knowledge for the sake of its power, you watch out for the intellectuals. They're very dangerous. They're bereft of understanding and possessed of the other guy. You want to take over a country, start with the universities. Because those are the people who've sacrificed knowledge for understanding. They have no understanding. They hate it. Because they have arrogance sitting in the throne, unholy in the place of the holy. People like me scare them to death. Guarantee you. There's not a single one in this country that can stand on a podium and discuss with me intelligent things that I'll frame the debate all the time. They will start and I will finish. I'll get them to ask them how they understand certain things. And that'll be the end of it, because they all have is memory. They have no understanding of it at all. There are a few who have a mixture, a mingling of it, because not all intellectuals are that wicked. But I'm saying in the very extreme, intellectual can sacrifice complete knowledge, understanding for knowledge and power. And that person has a dangerous spirit operating through them. They are clever and smart, almost indispensable with the amount of knowledge they have. They may become heads of a university or a school, and you will look up to them and use them as a template for your own, to model yourself after. You don't want to do that. You don't want to model yourself after anyone who's smart. You don't want to be jealous of who's smart. You got a smart brother or sister? Don't be jealous of them, because the jealousy will rob you of your own real smarts. And if you ever excel and overcome them and be better than them, you'll be worse off. I don't know if I'm taking it too far. It's all knowledge. So you got to be stupid to be. In other words, you got to be stupid smart, not smart stupid. Microphone. Stephen, okay.
My name's Steve, and I'm an alcoholic. Oh, is this the AA meeting?
Wrong place. Mm-hmm. No. On some of your books in the back, you have people giving you credibility who are PhDs.
Yeah, they're good people.
Yeah, so I guess there is a...
There are always some of those. They're survivors.
Yeah, there's people that I guess the rest of the world looks at that and they say, oh, well, that's a person with a PhD and he's validating Roy.
Well,
crossover.
There's nothing wrong with me using that because it's helpful. Otherwise, they're going to say, who's this upstart? Here's some PhDs, psychiatrists. I have friends who are psychiatrists, friends who are doctors. And they say I have the missing half of medicine. So there are people who have come out of their stupor and they are practicing, they're good doctors. A person who, here's the point, and I'm glad you brought it up. If you are an intellectual and you've compensated because you feel inferior and you go to school and you're shining bright and you're a people pleaser and you swallow everything and you accept everything and the teacher loves you and you wake up one morning and you may feel like it's the dead end. Something's wrong. It's dry. And so I say to that person, don't throw your knowledge away because very often they get depressed. They walk away from their business when they're very good at. I can't do this anymore. I can't stand it anymore. But the knowledge is fine. It's good to be a doctor. It's good to be a psychiatrist. It's good to be a teacher. See? And it's good to have learned. The learning of the Bible and everything there could have a value if you realize that you can't incorporate it into your being and it will work for you. There's no grace there. It is the ego getting grace for itself and eating every word, eating of the knowledge of good and evil, devouring it like a pig. You know, what does it say in the Bible about don't cast pearl before swine because they don't know the difference between, they can't appreciate the beauty of a pearl. Not that I think it's very pretty anyway, but I got the point. See, so you could take that knowledge and it will parade itself in front of you, because it will. Then you go, oh, I see that now. You don't need the book anymore. Or you can read the book if you want to. But since it's in your head, it will come by. And the pertinent ones, the ones you need to start with, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, will pick that out for you. It will show you exactly where you begin. I can't learn like other people learn. I won't learn. I didn't know why I couldn't learn, why I was fourth in the class and there was only four in the class. You see, it isn't that I was stupid. None of my teachers thought I was stupid. I just couldn't learn very well and wasn't terribly interested in it. It was all boring. I managed to read and write and learn some arithmetic and not very good at spelling. But I have a tendency which is natural and inborn and should never be deprived of it or think of it as foolish. As the way of the world, is to only to scan the information in front of me. I look at you, I look at you, I see what you say, I look at what scientists say, I look at the math, I look whatever it is. I don't want to know, I don't even know what it is I need. But I need to know something. But I don't need you to tell me what it is that I need. I need to know what it is, and that inner knowing is a teacher. Call no man father and no man teacher. You only have one and he's inside you. And so, lo and behold, I would notice, and it would be something absurd. It could be, I'm an emotional person, I'm in the Blitz in London, and I get very emotional, I hear some stupid music wafting through the air, and it sticks in my head and I can't get rid of it. There's that kind of thing happens. People that learn all kinds of absurd things under duress, and they can't get rid of it. No, something with me is different, and I'm trying to impress on you that you already have that, otherwise you couldn't hear me. Otherwise, it's impossible to hear me if you can't recognize it when you hear it. And if you recognize it when you hear it, it means you already have it. I'm jogging you. I'm jogging that memory, that process. Then you say, oh, that's right. Why am I so studying? Look, all that tension. I'm trying to find what I'm not going to find. No. I see something. I don't care what it is. Let's pick something. I always pick the same things just to make the point. A falling leaf. Why would I remember a falling leaf? A baby cry, a headline from the news, something about that headline. All those things stick. I don't know why. Then I wake up one morning, bingo, 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 they come together. I really understand something I never thought before. Now, that understanding, I could throw the words away, because words could mean those same things. The falling leaf could mean something else next time. I've thrown the words away. I've still got a falling leaf. I know what a falling leaf is. But for some reason, it's not important. The understanding is important. Now I'm closer to what understanding is, a more completeness of that understanding. And so it goes on forever. I don't have a head full of words. I have understanding that leads to understanding, which is never ending. And that understanding has eternal life in it. And the words are death. So you got to have words. I'm using words. I'm using two words to tell you, don't study words. See? Did I say you couldn't read? Sure you read. Because there's something about that particular, one word can have 10 meanings. Try to be a translator and try to trade one word, because one word can have 10 meanings. And 100 meanings depending on the context. So what have you got? You can take a word and make anything you want of it. When you argue with people, you've got to be very careful. They twist. The rhetoricians, the sublime rhetoricians intoxicated by the exuberance of their own verbosity. Quoting Disraeli speaking to Gladstone. I remember that for some reason. See, the thing is, you will understand. And you, not only that, but your purpose will come with it. You know, the TV satellite you have, the dish, there's a stream of energy coming from that. And energy contains information. So understanding is a stream of energy containing information, but it isn't words. So when I write my books, my feeble mind, my intellectual mind is not capable. So I write, and then I can look at it, and then it doesn't say it. See? I see, I'm self-correcting. I wrote it down the best I could with the skills that I had. You can only do that with what skills you got. Who's giving me the skill to write? Who's giving me the skills to speak? It ain't me. But with writing, I got no one to talk to. At least I can talk to you. I'm talking to myself. I'm writing, and I look at that, and I leave it alone for a day or two, and I come back, and it doesn't say it. I thought I said it. I did say it. I said it close. So I add a word or two. But I'm adding a word not because I'm clever, because I see, oh, I've missed that, and I've misstated that, and I can keep doing that, and I end up with a book. And I can read my own books, but those books I write are scary to other people, because it's exactly what I'm doing exactly in that book, the opposite of what they're doing in their head. So I try to say in this article, restoring the soul, a little girl, you don't get the courier, so let me read it to you, just a few minutes. A little girl went into her father's room late one night and said, "Daddy, I see a big spider in my room. I don't think it's a real one, but it seems more in my mind, but it scares me just the same." In that case, says the father, "you must watch that spider until it disappears." And the child returned to her room and quietly watched that dream world spider and soon fell into a peaceful sleep. This simple story illustrates one of the most vital lessons we all must learn. Observe all problems in a detached manner and they will finally melt away. That's the problem part of it. There's also a positive side to it. Evil operating through its emotional medium of imagination cannot stand observation. What comes in with your emotional learning is an entity. That is another thing you've got to realize. You don't just get learning, you get the entity. It goes with it. And it's called pride. And it sits on the throne of knowledge. Dream phantoms cannot affect you as reality does when constantly observed by a mind that's detached and aware. With the true presence of mind, there is unrealized power to counter all torments. Do not be tempted to resent past memories, feelings, and thoughts as they surface in the light of observation. That struggle is a big part of your downfall. Through the faithlessness of struggle, you energize those daymares, I call them, with your soul's very own life force. You actually make yourself worse in the struggle. So what you allow to get on the inside, outside, what you reacted to on the outside, now is what you're reacting to on the inside, and you're giving it power and to torment you more. You must come to know that Jesus himself was born knowing that he could do nothing except the Father act through him. Just as soon as you realize this, it transforms instantly into the faith necessary to stop you from the futility of trying to save yourself. Excerpt from the book, How to Conquer Negative Emotions. When you read my books, would you remember that you just read them at any open of any page? You don't have to start from the beginning, unless you want to. And then don't read too much. Read until you come to a paragraph, which the first page will stop you. Any page you open will stop you, because the whole answer is there. It's just a different facet of where you're coming from. In the spoke, the center of the wheel has different spokes, leading to and from the center. Okay, so now I'll take my calls now.
Do you mind if I give a little bit of a personal background before I frame my question?
I would rather you tell me what the question is than then give me the background.
Okay. If
Because I don't want to be compromised by your explanation of it.
Right. Sometimes when I see suffering or pain or evil in this world, sometimes, you know, I can look back into my childhood and see it, but sometimes when I see those things, it hurts my faith because I wonder why. It goes along with your explanation of understanding, but why is there so much pain in God's world? Why is there so much pain?
It's a very simple answer. You questioning what you're doing is really shaking your fist at heaven, yeah, aren't you?
Yes, because when...
Well, what is free will, though? What does it mean by... You have free will?
Yeah.
No, you don't.
No?
That thought you had was given to you, and a billion other people have the same thought. Where did it come from? Were you born with a thought, or did it come to you?
I guess I look at it as I have a choice in my life to do good or to do, I can see instances where I make my choice to do evil or to do good.
Yeah, but the point is, you got to be very careful with the thought. Because that could put a doubt in you about something like free will. You know, why does God allow that? Well, how could he not allow it if he gives everyone free will? If he gives you the free will to kill me, you have the choice between good and evil, and you choose evil and you kill me. I've got the free will to defend myself or whatever. Or I don't, or I'm a baby, so what can I do? My father had the free will to do the right thing, and his grandfather had the free will to do the right thing. They never did. You know what a liberal is, don't you? A person that lets things happen until he has to fight, and even if, you know what Churchill said? Let me just make a point. Churchill says, if you do not stand up and fight for what you know is right, there will come a time when you have to fight. There will come a time that you'll have to fight. He says, but there's something that's worse happening. You'll have to fight. You'll have to stand up and fight. I'm trying to get the right words. Even though you're going to die. Oh, he says, let me repeat it. He says, you're going to fight even though you're not going to win. But there's the worst case scenario. I got it now. There's a worst case scenario. He says, then you're going to have to fight. Know that you're not going to win and die. He says, but at that time, it will be better to die than live as a slave. That's Churchill. There's a certain kind of human being that is a slave already. And a big portion of the world is like that already. In this town, in this country, big part of the Americans, big part of the world have submitted themselves to worldly authority through fear and trembling. And they convert, in their egos, they do not see that servitude for what it is, slavery. They see it differently because they want to see it differently. How can a mercenary ego, prideful ego, admit it's a slave? It will see it as loving kindness. They will be subservient to the bully. The subservience to the bully will always look like love for that person, a love that eventually will redeem them, or the glorious love of serving someone they made a god, because if they didn't make it a god, they couldn't be a god maker greater than the god. It is a crazy thing in the mind. So most of the world, being liberal or having that mindset, which is a form of insanity, will always gravitate to the worst in human nature and glorify it. You're always attracted to that which corrupted you or a facsimile of it. That's why you're always drawn to the wrong people in marriage, and you elect politicians, and eventually your civilization falls. The worst human beings rise to the surface. And so right now, most of the world serves the beast. The Bible calls it the beast, the man who has the beast in him, who knows how to call that loyalty forth. And so, can you stop the beast? The beast can't be stopped because their forefathers and great-grandfathers and great-grandfathers gave them the legacy. And so, if you go to Borneo, you don't dare stand up. They'll kill you. And so, how are you going to stop all that? In other words, the sins of the fathers, this is in the Bible, the sins of the fathers are projected on the third and fourth generation for those that hate me. But showing mercy for those who love me and keep my commandments is always a remnant. Those that die will die. They will die at the hands of those who were elected to be murderers. Our forefathers helped them to be tyrants. They bear the responsibility of the death of the children. But there are those who survive who... Why was Jesus a little different from all the others? Remember in Bethlehem, they got the word, get out, they're coming to kill you. And then they killed every child in Bethlehem, but Jesus got away. Something different about that child. There are something different about survivors. Do you want to know something? If you look at all the little children right now, all the innocent children, some of them are not going to end up so innocent. See, if I've looked at my friends, I went back to England and I saw my friends and they were fun friends, but never got into anything serious. Drug addicts. One man's married and all his kids are liberals and his wife hates him. He's as bald as an egg. You know, and I see all these different, and one's laughing about being a drug addict and his own kids being drug addicts. He's always making jokes now. He's making jokes about that. He's better off dead. I have to tell you, all the kids that grow up, some of them will change. Some of them, there's something in them that will count for something. But most men, women, and children will not count for anything. Whether they die early or sooner or later, it's the inheritance. Do you think Jesus would be born in Borneo? Or would he be born in the only place he could survive? You got America. You got the best place you can survive right here. So why aren't you standing up for your rights when you've got your rights? When people already died for it? What you're doing is setting the stage for your own children to be murdered. And you will have to bear the guilt of it. See? So I'm standing up. And I'm going to stand up. And so take it upon yourself that the children, if you don't stand up for what's right now and stop worrying about whether God is a fair God or not, just do what you're supposed to do right now. That's all you got to do. Nothing more than that. Be a good husband. Be a good father. Take your stand against your wife, your children. There's no such thing as blood when it comes to right and wrong. Right or wrong? Take your stand. And if every man in this country would suddenly do that, man, would we be a force? Peace would break out all over the world. But if we wait too long, we try to be peaceful. See, if that something's missing in us, if for every person there's something missing in it, it encourages the enemy, emboldens the enemy to destroy us. And destroyed we deserve. Don't you think Rome deserved to be destroyed sooner or later? When it once was the mightiest of all nations, it was better than America. For 400 years, it enjoyed the most magnificent republic or democratic republic there ever was. 400 years. The last 400 years, it deteriorated. Murder and mayhem, because they allowed things to go wrong, like we're allowing the liberalization of this country, the yielding to the worst in human nature. And each one of you are yielding to the worst in human nature. Everybody sitting in this room deserves death. Don't you think you don't deserve it? You may not die in battle, but you die in some hospital room with some doctor not caring about you like Terry Schiavo, or worse. It's only a matter of what hill you're going to die on. Choose your hill. That's what life is about, dying. Life is about dying. It's about living to die on the right hill. You see that? So which hill are you going to choose? You don't know what it is yet, but prepare yourself for it in the little things. So you can't do anything about what failures of other parents. Whole nations have lived under tyranny because after a while there wasn't anybody to stand up. They just made sure of that. Do you think the Iraqi people could have saved themselves? The Soviet Union could have saved itself? Nazi Germany could have saved itself? See what happens? Whole countries get poisoned. And we're becoming poisoned. I can hardly get somebody in this room. I can advertise it and I say, look, I've got common sense. Here's how I can help you. Every week, maybe I get one, two. They're reading it. They're afraid of what their neighbors might think. You went to Roy Masters' lecture. See, that's what they are. Look, it's a good thing I have radio and I had 130 stations because, you know, I couldn't make it in a town like this. But look how few. And didn't Jesus say, narrow is the way and few are those that find it?
It's just being proved out.
That's all. Now, does that answer your question or not?
Yeah, pretty much. I see that, you know, a lot of suffering is brought on by man. You know, but then
you bring your own suffering on by your weakness.
You know, when I was a kid,
yeah.
You know, I can remember praying all the time at night, and I felt like I was close to God. And then when my parents got divorced, I can remember being so angry at God, and I can remember
there it is.
I can remember telling kids how I was like 12, and I was like, "How can there be a God when this? How can there?" I can remember saying this to people. And then when my dad died when I was 17, your dad died young, and
I never said that to myself.
Yeah, I know, and I wish that I hadn't. But in that suffering, it taught me to seek God, but there was also an anger.
I can hear it. I picked up on it right away, didn't I?
And so the reason that I think it got kicked up this week is a lady at work, you know, they thought maybe she had cancer in her leg or whatnot. It turned out most likely not to be. But when I see that suffering, disease, or things that don't seem to be brought on by man.
You're wrong. You're not seeing. You're not looking deep enough. You're not smart enough.
Yeah.
Every sickness. I have disease brought on by not myself. I was swimming in the ocean. And if you go there now, they've got signs on the beach. enter at your own risk. That wasn't there then. And then I got into trouble with all, then I began to understand about the medical profession. I wouldn't exchange that for the world. I'm not as healthy as I should have been, could be right now. But still, what I've learned is extremely valuable. It's humbled me and strengthened me in certain ways. But you're not smart enough to understand that question.
So your answer is take a stand for what's right and all the little things, faith grows from that.
Your mother and father didn't, there's God, but your mother and father didn't know him. There's God, and if you're not careful, you won't know him. And then you won't be able to do what they're too busy trying to get something from each other that they couldn't give.
Right.
Too selfish people, right?
Right.
It's your parents. If your parents had come to my seminars, maybe things would be different. I got some nice letters that say otherwise. I got some beautiful letters that families grew to be families. However, my father died. He didn't tell me much. He was a good, decent man. As much as I can remember, I don't remember what he looked like hardly. And then my mother died when she was 54. She dropped dead. I was carrying her around from motel to motel when I was on the road with a baby and my wife. I didn't leave her alone. But then she wasn't deep. She was a nice woman, but not deep. I wasn't angry at God. I don't know why I wasn't. Why would I? Why would I be angry at God? There's life and death. My father had a life, and the kind of life he led him to an early death. He smoked 5 packs of cigarettes a day, so that would tell me something. He was troubled, but he didn't show the trouble. He was always decent, hardworking, could speak 11 languages, could fix anything, motorcycles, cars, everything. Couldn't get a job. There was a depression. But he was a good person. Surface good, not good enough. Die early. Keep it suppressed. The good die young. Why do the good die young? Because they suppress their wickedness. See that? What can you do? I remember what a man said to me when I told him the way he was emotionally reacting would give him ulcers. He says, I don't get ulcers, I give them. See that? So he's healthy. He gets it. The violent, the angry, hostile people can get away with that and live for a long time. The old grandma, that mean old grandma, and everybody's sick and dying around her. Leukemia, God knows what. She's the healthiest one. Look down the chain. The sickest one is the smallest little kid. Look at North Vietnam, North Korea. They're dying from hunger, eating each other. They're healthy at the top. It's only because there's a lack of spirit. A lack of spirit in those people until there is no more spirit. It's like the Jewish people. You know, before you get into the gas chamber, you could have stood up and said, and get shot, or trying to escape, or joining the underground, or something. You knew it was coming, but they didn't. Some people escaped. They had the sense to escape. They came to America, or they tried to get to another country. They did. Underwent hardships. Some were so attached to their Mercedes and their shops. Well, the will of God, it'll happen, you know. Maybe we can reason with Hitler. See, there's a mentality. Doesn't see reality. They can't move in the direction because they're not guided. They don't have that understanding. Even Jesus' family ran away and hid until the time. It's an old saying, he who fights and runs away lives to fight another day. Do your thing. Don't worry about the whole world and the injustice of the world, because it's every father's failing. Every bitch and every son of a bitch in the world. Breeding themselves exponentially until the normalcy of a society is bred out. And you become the brave new world. But the savage, the only one that has any sense, is not taking soma. He's not on drugs. Half the country's on drugs. And the whole country's on drugs when you consider pharmaceuticals. There is use for it, but not to just deaden the pain of living wrong. Because living wrong means there's no will to fight and stand up and do what you need to do. It's gone. You're dying. You've got suppressed rage, expressed rage. The prisons are full. The mental hospitals are full. And the buffoons are ruling in the Democratic Party. It's happening. It's all because cowardliness. There's nothing wrong with the human race except no faith, which means cowardliness. Perfect love casts out fear. And coming back to the story of my lecture this morning, the theme of it is that you can't learn to be brave. You can't drink to be brave. You can't be angry to be brave. It's stupidity. You can't hate your father and take it out on your enemy. Goody, goody, there's a war. I don't have to kill my father anymore. See? All that is wrong. There's a proper way of standing up. There's a proper way of reading. There's a proper way of writing. There's a proper way of making love. There's a proper way of everything. Then the other way that looks right, but the end is destruction. That fine difference takes a fine heart, a searching heart, a sincere heart that gets it. Good Lord. Hello.
Hi. Sort of had a what appears to be a setback last week.
Uh-oh, you got upset with your wife.
Extremely. Okay, plus a few other people. And it's in reference to what you're talking about today. I have very strong tendencies to read a lot of your material, thinking that it will accelerate the understanding.
It won't.
I know, and I really got sucked into believing something about myself that wasn't absolutely true until the roof came down on me.
Fair enough.
And then I reacted very bad, very, very bad.
Because of what you, because it was just more of an act than a facade than it was real. That's how you test it. That's how it's tested.
Yeah, and like you've said so often on your radio program, I immediately, you know, I had thought I had a grip on food and sexuality and all that stuff. Boy, I just went right back like a drug addict.
I haven't got a grip on anything. I'm just get up in the morning. I'm just me. That's all I am. I don't feel like I have mastery of anything. I just carefree. See, people who know me know that I'm not clever, not smart.
I think what I want to ask you. I think I was spending more time reading than I was meditating, and that's why.
You don't have to spend a lot of time meditating. You just have to get yourself in a right frame to face the day and face the night.
But I think I was using understanding to think I had a certain strength.
And you didn't.
And I didn't.
It was the knowledge that gave you a false sense of knowing that gives you the power. It's the knowing that gives you the power. I think I know this now. Yeah. This man's making a lot of sense. I really like it. And so you study. Big mistake. Okay. It's the ego at work. So you got, it's a trap.
Yeah.
It's that trap. It's that little side. There's something inside you that makes it. See, that couldn't happen to me because it could, I suppose, but it didn't. I mean, I only hear it. I only hear you say that. I know it's possible because I hear you say it. I understand it, though, when you say it, but it didn't happen. Because it didn't happen, it seems odd when you say it. See, I mean, I've learned from people. I've learned what not to do just by, so I didn't have to do it myself. Oh, that's what that little feeling looks like in real life. That's how it shows. Oh, I know. I felt that little twinge before and I wondered about it. Goodbye. See?
This thing called understanding, I thought I had it.
That's the title for this, The Thing Called Understanding. Okay, good.
Because I would read something and I thought it was an aha experience. I really believe that.
But you get excited about it. You got to be very excited. When you have an aha experience, there should be no excitement about it. It just be very quiet. Ah, that's what it means. But if you get an excitement, the emotional state will energize the memory and steal it away. That's how serious it is. No, you quietly enjoy it. There's no way. I can explain it. It's just this, it's almost like it's a relief inside you to know it. But it's not excited. I have a friend of mine who's a doctor. I talk to him for 3 hours sometimes a month. We talk because he needs me as I need him. And we exchange. He's got the other half. I've got the other half of what he needs. And I told him, I said, 12 years ago, you told me things I couldn't hear. The reason is because you are so excited and so willful. I mean, you don't think you're willful when you're excited, but you so want so badly someone to hear it, you drive them away. You rob them of the choice. Because when you have excitement in anything, you want to share it with somebody. They have to hear it with the freedom to accept it or reject it. But if you emotionalize it, you give them the choice to accept it emotionally or reject it emotionally. And they don't get it at all.
Example, have you heard about Jesus?
That's right. You got it.
Well,
they're all nuts. You expect them to understand all these things?
I think that's part of the equation, is that I thought I had the understanding, and then I get on this campaign to share it with my immediate family.
You can't do it.
And what I found out through a very emotional communication is they hate me for it.
Well, they may hate you for it if you just stand there and look at them.
I wasn't looking.
No, what I'm saying is that you could be hated for someone just be sitting in this audience. They wouldn't dare to come. They couldn't even sit through with this. That's why they're not even here to argue with me. But the thing is, you can just live the life and be hated for it and just be very quiet and careful with your choice of words and make little quips about things because it's lighthearted and fun. And doesn't everybody see that? And you're not preaching. But to them, it's like a bomb went off. You're like hitting them with a brick. So I don't know whether they're hating you for one reason or the other. I hate you for pushing the truth on them or just living truthfully.
Then it really wouldn't make any difference because and I don't know, again, if I'm deceiving myself, what I decided. You know that expression, you don't waste pearl on the swine.
Yeah. Well, that's but then it. You can say, you can say, you, then you can go make it, you can make your life worse by thinking, stupid fool, I won't waste my pearl on swine. And then it could be a little contempt. Oh, then you complicated it. There may not be swine. They may or may not be swine, but it is a saying and not designed to make you contemptuous. It's just truth. Don't waste your words when you see you're not appreciated. So, but it's not meant to teach you to contempt. So you got to be very careful you don't compound your arrogance with that. I don't get to write this in books because we can only have this in conversation.
You're talking about these variations, and I would truly like to know what is the problem with me.
Ego.
Ego.
Pride. It's a serpent. It's the subtlest of all the creatures in the garden, remember? It's got you in a couple occasions, but just keep going.
Okay, so even taking your material, thinking I have understanding, I'm just feeding my big fat ego.
Yeah, that's right. That doesn't mean to say you got to be careful how you understand it. I said it to you. Careful you don't get carried away. Wow, this is marvelous. There's an emotional thing that will make you fall from the very thing that you need to rise to. See? No emotion. It's a freedom from emotion. It actually frees from you from the emotional state. It's called faith. Faith is very quiet. You don't even know you have it.
And I'm just better off alone again, back to the quietness. Because I went out and tested it, and what it revealed is it just filling my big fat ego.
Yeah, because you're too eager to be somebody who spreads the word. It's don't you see how hard it is to be a preacher?
You're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. I mean, it's like you're sitting there and you see something. It's so clear.
Come close to the microphone.
With the understanding that I have, even if it's for my ego, I really see things. I know I see in the truth. And when I try to reach out and help a person understand, I don't get frustrated. Well, maybe I do.
See, I learned on the radio a long time ago. I started to tell people the truth, and I see they didn't understand. I saw a little irritation. I said, that's silly. I'm to give you the information, and you can take it or leave it. I don't care what you do with it. If you get better, don't blame me. If you get worse, don't blame me. And you say, well, you know, I recovered from cancer. I said, that's nice. My father dropped dead trying to find it. There's a story in one of my books where these two ladies, mother and daughter, had a very violent husband, father. And the change came over these two girls, ladies, mother and daughter. And he couldn't get to them anymore. And it frustrated him to no end. He couldn't stand it. So he found out this record and he's listening to it. He's trying to find out what the secret is. And one day they found him dead listening to the record going over and over and over again. See? I said, I don't care. And they didn't care either. Truth can kill you or cure you. Be careful. It's not something you mess with. Do you understand why people don't mess with me? Unless there's a whole bunch of them? Unless it's the whole bloody media? You know? Right? Because it's death. It's death to engage in discussion with a person who will deal with you only in truth, the very thing you can't stand. The very thing you're trying to destroy shines brighter in that person. It is a frustration of hell. You better stay away. Or take a gun and shoot him from a distance. You don't want to get too close. I didn't have my wife live with me this long. All right, go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to talk to you about my mother. I have not been able to let go of the anger that I have for her.
Sad. And but that's your fault.
It is my fault.
What do you want from me?
Talking to you helps.
Okay.
Discover something that's like missing. And I still have this fear of talking to you, so maybe I killed two birds with one stone.
Okay. I hope I'm not one of the birds.
I think that I realize part of my problem talking to you is my pride. You know, because
but you're addicted to the sense of righteousness depends on hating something wrong. It's not just your mother; it's everything. Yeah, isn't that right? It's spread to everything. So it's an energy, it's an ego energy that depends upon judgment to sit high and mighty, albeit secretly in your mind, even though you're a sniveling coward. See, but the booby prize is you get to serve people. You get to serve your mother, who's a big bully or whatever. See? And the more you give to her, the more big a bully she is. And somehow you cannot be kind enough to her, because the kinder you are, the worse she is. And then she becomes a bigger and bigger monster. And everybody you live with and everybody you work with, you do the same thing to them. They hurt you. But here you are, this nice, sweet person serving all these monsters. You're God. In a sense, you're sitting there judging all the... It's like God judging the devil. If you've got nothing else, you've got this big devil. You've created a judge. At least you're not like them. You're sweet and kind and serving. You have love. No, you don't. You love the devil. You see, you're loving the worst than everybody. You think your love is a form of control. Your love, you think your love can cure them. You just haven't loved enough. It's not the truth. It's like a form of insanity. You make the same mistake over and over again, expect a different result. That's what love is, a form of insanity. Human love, that is. So well, when are you going to give it up? Pronto.
But what I wanted to tell you is a recent experience with my own daughter helped me to see that I had revenge in my heart.
You know, Brooke Shields hated her own newborn baby. She was on Oprah Winfrey one night. And I'm just remembering what Wendy just told me. Well, you told me that, didn't you, Wendy? And so I can just roughly relay it to you. She had a baby, and she had some serious complication, almost died from having the baby. She had postpartum depression, but you can see where this comes from. Suddenly, she has this terrible hate towards the baby, because if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be in this position. See? There's the horror in there. That's postpartum depression, which is the baby is responsible for your suffering. Whatever the suffering is, there's hatred and the depression that comes from the hatred. That's just, and then you can kill your baby, and it's justifiable homicide because you're emotionally disturbed. No, you're emotionally wicked. So did I run away from the point, or did I make the point?
No, actually, that had a part in it too, because I have resented my kids.
Why? Because they don't love you?
They don't worship. Hardship. Uh-huh. I ended up destroying my marriage, being part of what destroyed my marriage, so I had to raise them by myself.
Well, first of all, you resented your husband, like your mother.
And I brought all my problems
on yourself
into the marriage. And
there you go.
I was a handful for him, just maybe more than he could handle.
Yeah. I'd have crushed you like a fly. If you were ever married to you, I'd have crushed you like a fly. You've been a good person.
You've been working on it.
No, but you would have been. I would have crushed the dark side of you.
I know. But I get confused sometimes.
My wife's got a big dark side. So it's harder to crush.
Sometimes when you crushed me, I thought you were in the wrong. No. I apologize.
I'm not hitting you and beating you over the head.
I know. But it's because my parents were abusive and my father is very similar.
So you think when you listen to me, I'm abusive. It feels that way sometimes.
It feels that way sometimes.
But it isn't true.
I know. I think
that's why you can't get well. That's why you can't get well.
That's a lie. It's the pain.
It's the pain
that you inflict. Bring up inside.
Yeah.
That's a good pain.
But if
I get mixed up between that pain and the other pain.
Are you mixed up in it now?
Not really.
Good. Sit down. You'll be fine. Now I know the difference, don't you? I'm a good guy. I'm not ordinary man. I'm not your father and I'm not your husband. Okay? And I love women. Not all of them.
Time too, when you explained that Jesus loved me, because I guess I thought he was mad at me.
Well, no, he's not mad at you. He's still, if I love you, I look like I'm mad at you. So if I say, hey kids, that's enough. Well, that sounds like I'm mad at him, doesn't it? Well, I could be mad at him. That's bad. But I could pretend to be mad at them. I really love them. I have to put on a show. And they know that I love them still. But they need the force. The non-violent force. The average person can't say, hey, kids, go to bed, without having the violent force. See the difference? Love is a non-violent force. I can use force non-violently. But it looks like I'm mad. I look fierce. Just for the kids, and they run up the stairs. And they run up the stairs laughing, you know, because they know the monster's coming. But really, they know I'm not angry with them. But it's a great show. And they need the show. They need the firmness. They're little animals. They need the firmness.
For more information, please write to Post Office Box 1000, Grants Pass, Oregon 97528, or call us toll-free at 1-800-877-3227. You may also visit us on the World Wide Web at www.fhu.com.